Hi folks, thank you so much for checking out this latest episode of our little YouTube show, Soundtrack and Extra, which is a little companion piece to the podcast, Soundtracking. And this week I've got a really great, fun, really varied show for you. We've got Ewan McGregor, we've got Kat Deeley, my old friend, my lovely friend, and Craig Roberts. So first up, Craig, who I'm a massive fan of. I think he's such a great talent. A lot of you will know him from his acting work, and he's got a great kind of diverse repertoire, everything from Submarine, the Richard Ayoade film that I first saw him in, right through to Horrible Histories and everything in between. He's got this great fine line between drama and comedy and does both well. And then what I'm really impressed with, even more so, is his ability as a director. His new film, Eternal Beauty, is out in cinemas today. Please go and see this film for many reasons. Support an independent film. Go in to watch a fantastic film. And it's just a brilliantly, brilliantly film across the board. He's written it, he's directed it, he's not in it. Stars Sally Hawkins as this character, Jane, who's very loosely based on his own experiences with his aunt, who suffered from mental health issues. And I think it is a beautifully crafted, funny, poignant, beautiful, emotional look at the complexities of mental health and how the people around individuals who suffer from various things, mental health issues, to the individual. And Sally Hawkins is pristine and beautiful and perfect in this role of Jane. So it was a real treat to sit down and chat to Craig. Now you can hear Craig in a more in-depth chat with all the music that he talks about on this week's podcast. He is this week's episode, so please do go and check that out on your usual podcast provider. And he talks at length about working with Michael Price again on the score, but then also a lot of needle drops that feature in the film, which we touch on in this chat. But please sit back and enjoy the wonderful Craig Roberts.
If you're just tuning in, welcome. Today's all about making a change.
How are you feeling?
Good.
Hello. I want to take care of you.
No depression?
No. You?
Funny.
Thanks. Hello. Have you been taking your tablet?
Hey, Jane, I'm sorry.
What happens if you don't?
Spiders come out of walls.
You're making it very difficult for people to like you.
Jane?
You're the most beautiful thing I've seen today.
What?
Shut up. You're dead.
You won't
react. Treat me like a child.
Get off me!
You need to wake up.
Wake up when I want to.
You're the love of my life, Jane. Do you trust me? I'm sorry.
Jane!
Thank you.
One thing that was super important for me is that it wasn't just just really dark and like super depressing.
Yeah.
I've seen a bunch of, in the run up to this, I was trying to watch as much as I could with cinema and, you know, its take on like mental health. And there was just a lack of humor in it, really. And I just felt that like, it was almost like people were afraid to laugh. Or laugh with a protagonist that's going through something like this. And from the movie's slightly based on somebody that I know, mm-hmm. and this person has always been very, very funny. And my family have, you know, built up a way to deal with it and laugh it off, or go along with what she's saying. And it was just super important, and it was certainly a challenge to like keep that in there, because yeah. it will make people feel uncomfortable sometimes. And I think that's absolutely fine.
Yes.
I don't think it's wrong. I think it's just, the way I was always pitching it was that it's a drama with comedy or humor rather throughout. And if it's not funny for anybody, then it's just a drama and that's fine.
Well, you kind of, comedy is a brilliant way of addressing kind of issues that make people feel uncomfortable in a way, isn't it? And it's kind of healthy in a way to be uncomfortable, because it means that you care and you're invested.
Absolutely. And it also if something is let's say trying to be funny, or there's humor pointed at in something, and you don't find it funny, then it doesn't have to be that it's wrong. It just happens to be that maybe you've not experienced that, or you don't have that. So that's absolutely fine. And I think it's important with the progression of talking about mental health and how much we talk about it, we need to look at it from all different angles. You know, it'd be an interesting double bill to play this next to the Joker, because they're both obviously two different takes on it. And, you know, one's very, very serious. And the others, you know, with slightly more humor in it, and there's no wrong way to do it. But I think, you know, that just shows that we should open it up and have different looking glasses for this.
What did you put on the carrots, Tony?
Coriander.
What is that? Hey, what's up? You all right? Christmas. It's Christmas. Take it.
His dog passed away this morning.
What?
His dog passed away this morning.
What did the dog die of?
Cancer.
Well, doctor did say it runs in the family. Oh. We've got to be careful. Yeah. I have to go because I don't like coriander.
Jane, sit down, please.
It really, you know, when you were talking about kind of wanting it to be a drama with comedy and dealing with kind of mental health, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest was the immediate one for me that kind of.
It's amazing. It's incredible. I watched that. Yeah, I watched that a few times before we're doing it, just to make sure. Well, also because it's so perfect. Good. The way it's made is perfect. It's just so good. It was certainly challenging to try and make this thing, because I don't think, because I knew the humor of the character or the protagonist, and it was certainly a goal to make sure that everybody's always laughing where they're not laughing at. And if you are laughing at, by the end of it, hopefully you realize that you've been laughing at the wrong person, and that maybe it's other people that.
Yeah.
Everybody
else made me feel uncomfortable.
That's good.
And not Jane. I just wanted to hang out with Jane, to be honest. I just kind of like.
That's good.
She's
just
so true. Yeah. She was so honest.
She's super honest. Yeah. There's no filter in it. And I kind of did hang out with Jane, because Sally, I was like friends with Sally beforehand.
Yeah.
And then when she did the movie, you know, we got closer and the friendship grew. But I realized that I was like becoming friends with this character, because she was like in character the whole time, pretty much.
Was she? So,
yeah. Well, on set, this is such a hard role to play. And there's so many places to go that she certainly stayed in it for a long time. And as much as she could during on set. And that was fascinating to see, and obviously sets a tone immediately for people coming into that. And everybody else as well. Like I always, you know, I've always wanted to, I've worked with David Thewlis, a couple of years ago. He wrote a short film, and when I was writing this, I definitely wanted Sally and David to be in it, because I felt like I hadn't seen, it's like the Michael Lee movie I hadn't seen. And then everybody else that we got, like Alice Lowe and Billy Piper and Penelope Wilton and Bob Pugh and Morbid Clark, we just lucked out with the cast. We were very lucky.
How much of it was on the paper? Did you know, are you a director? Because this has been, it's so brilliant to kind of watch, you know, kind of your journey as well with filmmaking. Kind of, you know, I think my first introduction to you on front of the camera was Submarine, obviously, which was fantastic. And then I remember speaking to you about Just Jim, and then, you know, kind of, it's so exciting watching the films that you're making and the stories that you're telling. And with this, I guess knowing, you know, it's funny you say about Mike Lee and stuff. Did you encourage improvisation? Did you encourage them to play with the characters? Or were you quite meticulous in terms of what you shot and how you shot it?
I was definitely quite meticulous with what I shot, because we were shooting on film, so we didn't have the freedom to like constantly like run the camera all the time. It was, we were very, you know, kind of a low budget. So we really didn't, it was, I had to know what I wanted going into it. But I definitely, I definitely encouraged it if it was good. Not that it was ever bad, but I definitely, you know, if it can make it better 100%, I'm not Tarantino where it's, you know, I don't, nothing has to be said exactly this way with this inflection. Mm-hmm. But I it's kind of a bit of both, I suppose. Like, if it's organic and it's wonderful, then fantastic. But as long as we get what we need and that, you know, I've got enough in the edit to play with, then I'm happy.
Was it, did you know when you were writing it how you wanted the film to sound, you know, in terms of music wise? Because there's this wonderful kind of both sides of it in terms of, you know, you have diegetic music. Oh, yes, I love when I get to use that word. Makes me feel like I'm really clever.
I love that word so much. Yeah.
But then obviously, you know, Michael's done the score again for you. And yeah, because obviously you have, you know, with Sally singing I Will Survive, you know, you've got to get clearance for that in advance and all that kind of thing. So how much were you writing into the script and kind of having an idea of that before you started?
That was in there. The Gloria Gaynor was in there and it was so expensive and it was ridiculous. Well, I changed the, you know, it's, that actually happened, that singing of that lyric, those lyrics with the actual lyrics that she says, because they're wrong. And so I wrote the lyrics in the script. And then I thought, well, this is not going to be that expensive because, you know, the lyrics are completely incorrect. But no, it was absolutely expensive. But I felt right to have it in there. With Michael, yeah, like I love Michael. I think he's amazing. And yeah, he did such a good job on the first one that I just definitely wanted to work with him again. And we had two sides of it. So it was the music that would essentially follow her around, which was, let's call it kind of, I suppose, punch drunk lovey in a way. That was probably a reference for it.
Yeah.
And with that, we used mainly, I know Michael used a lot of sounds that Sally had. So basically like ums or like ahs or anything that she did in dialogue, we took and then tried to make into music, essentially.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it was really cool because we just wanted it to be totally in her head. And then there was a nightingale that followed where there was this idea that, you know, her having this superpower that she could talk to anything or anyone. So there's a nightingale that kind of talks to her through the soundtrack as well in the music that follows her around. And then there was the kind of vertigo kind of the lush music that was almost like a movie that she was imagining, or like in any moment that was went really well for her, we kind of supported her with that and gave her the right kind of music that she deserved. So there was like two sides to it, and it was we wanted to make sure it felt right, but and was transitioned well. But it was kind of easy because the movie's always with her.
Yeah.
So if, you know, we're in her head always, so like that was fine. And then also like Taxi Driver's always a reference for any music, really, because it's just the best.
Yeah, totally. It's interesting you mentioned Punch Drunk Love, because I think that John Bryan score, and similarly, you know, in terms of the drama comedy element of that film, I think as well is
it's a masterpiece. Yeah,
yeah, it's just absolutely extraordinary. It's really lovely because even at the opening of the film, when the sound of the kind of orchestra warming up. And it's just it's a beautiful start. It's kind of like,
yeah. Yeah. Well, we did, when we LFF, we did the screening, the premiere for it. And we actually got like, a quartet on stage doing that actual, the warming up, and some of the music in the film before actually the movie played, because sometimes I feel like if you know the music in a film, you're going to have a better experience of the film. And obviously this was completely new music, so we were trying to sneak in some music before the film started to try and get into people's heads. But yeah, again, that was, I suppose, that came from certainly the, you know, the instruments warming up and stuff. And anything that was in her head, because that plays over her, the kind of, let's call it, the mind, the kind of, yeah, the talking her through how to be calm and radio piece at the beginning of the movie. Yeah. And it's that was again a challenge to put that in, because that's not the easiest way into a movie.
It's lovely though.
It's the most commercial way into a film.
It's almost like that thing, because you kind of, you know, and I love that sort of way that the sort of way that it can transport you almost, you know, so you're like, oh, I've got to sit down and get ready because they're warm, you know. It's such a lovely gentle way to kind of go, okay, we're about to start something.
Yeah,
it was lovely.
Yeah, certainly a nod to that as well, that kind of pre-music that would come in cinemas, I suppose, as well, but as you're sitting down. Yeah, look, I like old scores, I really do. So we definitely went for it, and Michael got us into Abbey Road to record it as well, so it was a wonderful experience.
Amazing.
It was really cool.
Did you get your picture taken on the crossing outside?
Yes, and then my mum came with me, and like Lord of the Rings is all the way through that, and she loves Lord of the Rings, so I was just constantly taking pictures of her in front of the posters.
Amazing. Craig there talking about his new film Eternal Beauty that is out in cinemas now. Please do go along and see it at the cinemas. Support your local cinema, independent film, and just go and enjoy the experience of watching a fantastically shot and told and acted story. It's one of my films of the year by far. It's so good. So that was Craig Roberts and Eternal Beauty. Next up, my wonderful and old friend, old in terms of we've been friends for a long time, Kat Deeley, who, you know, we lost her to LA there for a while, but she's back home, and what she's brought with her is this beautiful children's book that she has written, and I'll let her explain to you what it's all about. I read this last night. I love it.
Did you?
It's
you didn't read, hold on, you didn't read this last night, did you?
How did
this
you?
Rubbish.
Hold on, how did you get one? I tell you what, and I've known that you've been going to be doing this for a while.
In actual fact, ages. I mean, let's be very, very honest. I mean, ages. I mean, I remember talking to you about it after
over
you
lunch
wrote your
in
book,
LA.
And totally, and after you wrote your book, and I said, I want to do this children's book, and blah 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 blah, and you're like, yeah, do it. Oh my god, the procrastination has just been it's just so hard, I think, to do something like that, but in the end managed to get it done, went backwards and forwards, lots of different incarnations, but I think it's in a really good spot. You know, it was that moment where it was just the right time to write, essentially, because I got to a point where I could steal an hour here or there with like naps and going to play groups and things like that. So I could do that. And also I just wanted to write something for the boys, because at the end of the day, I am absolutely shattered and I can't talk. And I'm just wanna, I mean, how often have you been reading bedtime stories and fallen asleep before they have? I mean, sometimes
it's the nudge where I can, it's weird because I almost send myself to sleep by reading the stories. And
totally.
Particularly.
I've done it. And literally I feel like Paddy come and tap me. He's like, you've fallen asleep again. I'm literally like, oh, like dribbling.
It's
and like
spikes, like hand just goes like that. Mom. And oh, where was I sort of thing?
Totally. And that was my thing. I wanted something that was going to say everything I wanted to say when I couldn't find the words. Like, how do I want them to feel before they go to bed? Well, I want them to feel confident and know they're enough and know that they're loved and that the world isn't too big and too scary. You know, I'm all for telling kids the truth, you know, because I think it's very, very important.
Yeah.
That you don't hide anything from them, and because I think it's the unknown that scares kids. But I do also feel there's a place for, listen, Milo's four. He's got to feel warm and fuzzy before he goes to bed. Otherwise, when else in his life is he ever going to have that? So it's a kind of a collection of thoughts and feelings, emotions, ideas, and then it's top and tailed by love. And actually, when I read it to Milo, he said, Mum, he says, I love you so much, and I love Dad, and I love James. And it kind of gets them into this Zen place where they just feel everything is okay with the world, you know?
Well, I think it's a lovely kind of notion almost, because you don't know what's going on in their little minds when they're asleep.
No.
And so the idea that you are kind of sending them to sleep with, and it's not just filled with love and joy, it's filled with kind of positivity and that kind of, you know, you can achieve the things you want to achieve. And even if you, and it's about trying, and it's about following your dreams and using your imagination. And we've got this great book that I read to the kids called Dogs Don't Fly. And it's okay. It's kind of that notion that this kind of, if you don't try, you'll never know.
Yeah, basically. Yeah, and there's a lot to be said for just trying something and not being the best at it and enjoying it anyway, or learning from the experience of maybe failing at it, but then learning how to do that with grace and you know, because that's part of life's lessons too. Not everybody's going to be great at everything all of the time. But then on the flip side of that, there's also that thing which scares me a little bit, because I'm always like, what if they don't find the thing they're good at? You know, you know what I mean?
What if
Stevie Wonder had never played the piano, or Tiger Woods had never, you know, picked up a golf club, or Picasso had never picked up a paintbrush? You kind of turn around and go, my goodness, the world would be a much worse place because of it, you know? And I think it's to try and stimulate them as much as you possibly can right now.
Yeah.
And get all their little neurons firing and just keep putting the right things in front of them. And I don't mean that in a kind of weird tiger mom, you've got to become something that I want you to be. It's just you have to facilitate them being able to try everything.
Yeah. It's interesting because Rudy's 12 now, and he loves music. They both love music in different ways, and so he wanted to learn piano, and so we found this amazing teacher who isn't about following that kind of traditional route of scales and things. It's all about the imagination and about like, for example, he's into manga comics at the minute and stuff. Mr. Mander, his teacher, is kind of like, okay, well, let's try and create a kind of soundscape around that world. So here's the kind of notes that they would use in that. And so it's a really amazing way, like, to kind of ignite that kind of creative side, but bringing in something that it's really amazing, because to start with, he's like, I can't do it. I can't play the piano. I can't. And it's like, well, but you can. And so it's amazing having the inspiration from his teacher to kind of bring in something that he's already into to help inspire him on with the confidence to take it forward.
I think that is absolutely brilliant. And I think the other thing I would say to Rudes whenever he said that was, just think about John Williams and Jaws. It was two notes. Da-da. Da-da. Mm-hmm. I mean, nothing is greater than that. Look, it's given me funny old Chillerama runas, but like that's what it is, right? It's two notes, and it's the most incredible music, most recognizable of all time, and will put the fear of God into anybody that's out in open water if it started playing. Like, it's and that's it, you know? Like, it doesn't have to be complicated. It's just that thing of finding what it is that's brilliant.
Talking of music, when was the last time you picked up the clarinet?
Oh, my goodness. I can't even remember. It's actually in storage.
Oh, come on.
It's in storage because we've moved. So when we came back here, we've just rented somewhere. Essentially what happened was, we were going to just flip all this, but we were going to just flip everything around. And then Milo was assessed by his head teacher at this school that he's at. She was weirdly in America because she'd got family there. And she said, I can come and see him. Anyway, the plan was to come kind of this summer, really, and then start in September as it is now. When she came, she said, listen, he will love the school. He will thrive in it. It will be great for him. We'd be happy to have him. She said, but the only thing is if he could start in January, it would actually make his life so much more easy, because there were about four or five other kids that were starting at the same time. She said, however, if he comes in September, he might be the only new kid.
Yeah.
And listen, you know what it's like. You do anything for your kids. So Patty and I basically hustled like maniacs. We like packed stuff up. We went to live in my brother's 4-bedroom flat for 8 weeks. I mean, that was kind of 8 people and a dog. And we just made it happen, because you will do anything to try and make you would move heaven and earth for your children, right? If you possibly could, if you could make something happen, you have a go at doing it. And so that's kind of what we did. So it was all crazy. So we're in like a rented place here in Primrose Hill. It's got a great big garden though, which is lovely, because Milo's been used to being outside. You're obviously being in LA, you're outside loads, you're on the beach, you're in the hills, do whatever. So I wanted to make that as easy as possible for him. So yes, all things like that are kind of superfluous to requirements right now are still in storage. We also have our other house in LA with like 2 cars, and there's all stuff there too. I'm literally like the littlest hobo. Maybe tomorrow I'll find it. And just stuff everywhere.
You need to watch this. Weird, I was just talking to you about it. This film is coming out called Nomadland, which is about this character that Frances McDormand plays called Fern, who she lives. She just travels around and kind of lives out of a van, and she has this amazing sort of spirit that kind of fights against the kind of this sort of materialistic idea of having a house, so to speak. And you know, she has everything with her, and she just goes and explores and meets all these amazing people and stuff. I was slightly envious of her actually watching the show. It's kind of like the film. It's like it's a really lovely.
Well, I also feel that COVID's done that a little bit to us all as well. I weirdly feel a bit like, do I really need that? Nah.
Yeah.
But you turn around and you go, do I really? And I think it's going to be really interesting to see how the advertising industry responds to it, because we had been so conditioned that it was all about these trainers and this computer and that iPhone and this, that, and having things. And all of a sudden, we kind of realise it isn't really. It's about hanging out with family and doing things that are quite simple and entertaining each other and connecting with them. And I think it's going to be difficult for the advertising industry to get us all back on board.
Yeah.
After we've all kind of discovered, well, really, do we really like just disappear into an abyss if we don't have Kanye's trainers? I don't think we do. You know what I mean?
I could think of much better things to spend my money on. Thank you very much.
Exactly.
The only thing I've bought in lockdown in excess is
bananas.
Not bananas for banana bread. It's like bits of technology to be able to do stuff like this. So, you know, like cables and microphones and headphones and all that stuff. It's like, it's so, but it's kind of that thing where you kind of, for me, it was a knee-jerk reaction of going, okay, I need to be able to do stuff. So
facilitate stuff.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
totally. It's just, so. Oh my God.
But we've definitely shifted though. I feel like everybody has just, I think there's just a different way of thinking now. And I think that just me personally, I've definitely learned to, like, even just going out for dinner with people, you suddenly go, oh my goodness, that's so amazing. You know what I mean? To not eat food you've cooked is like, and it's funny because it just shifts everything, I think, in a really interesting way.
Before we go, I want to ask, have you been watching any stuff, any recommendations of anything that you've watched or books? I know you love reading books as well. You're a big reader. But What, give me a couple of recommendations for people of either something you've watched, something you've read, or...
Okay, so I would say my big binge watch that I just done, because you told me it's about to get super juicy, is The Crown.
Yes!
I cannot wait. I'm so excited.
Like, where are you?
Even see, I'm at the end. I'm like up to date.
Okay, great.
I'm completely up to date right now. I am waiting with bated breath for this new season with Princess Di. And I saw the cover of Vogue and I'm like, it's close. I can't wait. I'm so excited about it. Yeah. So that I've just kind of caught up with that just so I'm ready to go the minute it's all good. And then the book that I'm waiting, that's on my nightstand now, I'm waiting to dive into, is Dolly Alderton, Ghosts.
I've heard it's
I haven't
amazing.
Read it yet. I haven't read it yet. I've got a copy. She sent me a copy, and because I bumped into her, I went bumped into her in a pub weirdly. It's sitting there just waiting for me, just not to be tired or fall asleep at bedtime with dribble and snoring.
It's like two pages now I'm desperate to read. Margaret Atwood's The Testaments. Have you read that one?
I haven't, but I've heard good things about it.
I've got that there to read sort of thing. It's like, oh God, it's just finding the time to kind of do it, like you say. It's so weird.
Also, my whole thing is at the end of the day, when I can actually find time to do it, I'm so exhausted that I read two pages, then I fall asleep. And then when I wake up the next morning, I think, what was that? What were the two pages I read? And I can't remember. So yeah. I'm like,
Yeah, because you're thinking about everything else as well.
Yeah, totally.
Right. This is so great. And I really hope that it's the first of like a collection, because there's just the most beautiful message in this book. It really is. I think it's brilliant. You've done such a brilliant job, babe. It's gorgeous. Really is.
Thank you.
Have a good day.
You too.
In person.
Can't wait.
All right, my darling. Have a good day.
Bye, chicken. See you later.
Deeley, always a pleasure. Never a chore. Just weird having to interview your mate. But anyway, hopefully you guys enjoyed that. The book is out now, and it really is a joy to read to my kids. Both ages, they've loved it. Next up, Mr. Ewan McGregor, who was last week's guest on the podcast. So if you haven't listened to that yet, then please do go and check it out. Just search for Soundtracking with Edith Bowman on your usual podcast provider and subscribe, please, whilst you are there. And Ewan was on to talk about his latest adventure with his mate Charlie Boorman, Long Way Up, which you can hear and talk about at length. The series is up on Apple TV now, so do go and check it out. It's very, very good. But one of the things that I talked to Ewan about was music, both in terms of the music that's connected with his films, but then also the idea that particular characters that he's played have had a real kind of, you know, there's music involved within the narrative of the character. And as you'll hear as well, it's so wonderful to hear Ewan stand by his castmates when decisions look like they're being taken away from him as well for one particular film, Little Voice and Jane Horrocks. So here we go, Ewan McGregor.
In my head, whilst, you know, when you're playing Obi-Wan, you've got John Williams in your head, obviously, you know, it's that, those kind of Star Wars, seriously.
I remember Big Liam telling George, because I think at some point, it took so long to shoot those fight scenes that we were just sort of running out of steam. And George, one day, he said, "Action!" and he started playing the theme, the Star Wars tune, while we were doing it. And Liam just stopped and he went, "No, switch it off." So it just wasn't happening. Like, we can do it without the music, George.
That's hilarious. with something like, with the Trainspotting with Danny, though, you know, whilst you were shooting that first film, did you have any idea with regards to the kind of musicality of it in terms of how rhythmic the film was going to be with this sort of, you know, soundtrack, really?
I think no is the short answer. I don't. I remember seeing Trainspotting for the first time. I remember clearly. I was with my uncle Dennis and Ev. And we watched it in a screening room in Soho. And I remember coming out just sort of like, you know, not really being able to speak, like, oh my God. Because you don't know. That's what's brilliant about Dan, is you don't really know what's happening, what's in his mind, you know. You don't know the whole picture that he does. You know exactly, you know, there's never a better director to work with in terms of finding the scene and playing the truth of the scene and him pushing you to explore parts of yourself that you might not have thought about doing so on your own. He is, you know, my favorite, if you're allowed to have a favorite. He is that. But you don't. The only tip I had was, of course, we'd made Shallow Grave, and I'd already seen that. Seen what from the experience that we had on set to what that movie looked and felt like and sounded like. Afterwards was a real eye opener. That's why I that's why I was so, I just wanted to work with him all the time, you know, was one his actor, because it's just thrilling. And it was like Shallow Grave came out and we're like, oh, this is new, this is different. And Brian Tofano's photography was really key to that as well. He was just he was absolutely part of that. The genius of all that, coming up with these shots that were just, that just blew us away. You know, people weren't making movies like that in Britain at that time. So we were, it was really exciting. Yeah.
Yeah. When you think about Moulin Rouge as well, I mean, I watched that recently. It was one of my lockdown films of the kind of the many that I've had the time to go and revisit and enjoy again. And
does, that it was hold, such, does it hold up?
Absolutely. It's a wonderful kind of just glorious, luxurious experience.
Yeah. That's what it felt like to shoot. It was like a dream. It was like a big, it was like a big dream. It was amazing. Yeah, just amazing.
Look at your face when you talk about it. You got
it was. It was like, I'll never forget some of those, you know, doing that tango scene where walking through all those dancers and, I mean, literally the crane's going out the door of the set, you know, the studio. It's like, there's just vast music and colour and it was all there on set. It was all happening for reals. It wasn't, it was just amazing. It was just great.
Like a big playground.
Yeah, amazing. It was just amazing. It blew my mind.
And Little Voice as well.
Oh, yeah.
I was talking to someone about that the other day. And just Jane Horrocks, the performance of that as well was just extraordinary. When you're watching something like that as well, you know, being part of that wonderful ensemble, I mean, I'm kind of blown away. I didn't know that she had that capability when that film first came out as a singer and a, you know, that kind of mimicry thing that she does within for those characters, particularly for that film, obviously.
Yeah, it was written for her. You know, she did it on stage first. It was a play, and it was written for her. I don't know if I want to tell the story, but it was one of the things I remember. I was asked to do it, and then. Mr. Weinstein decided he was going to recast it and with an American star who I won't name and set it in America. And I went, well, okay, well, I'm not doing it then. And
good for you.
Because it's Jane's part, it's her, it was written for her. You know, who else could do that? Who else should do that, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, she just, the character and the complexities of that character is just absolutely, you know, under her skin really with that character. It's incredible.
Yeah. I had talent.
Yeah. I had the pleasure of speaking to Mr. Todd Haynes as well.
Oh, yes.
Oh, my God. He's like a proper musical nerd, isn't he? He's amazing. Yeah.
Amazing. He's really an interesting filmmaker.
Loved chatting to him.
It's like there's sort of two worlds of filmmakers, I think. And there's the team like Todd and Danny and there's like people have really got something to say. I've got they can't not say it the way they can say it, you know, visionary, creatively talented people. And then there's another side where, you know, people that can get by and know how to point a camera in the right place and everything. But, you know, it's just interesting how you work, how it's so satisfying to work in that first group and so not so satisfying to work in the other, you know.
But
it's life, isn't it? You work on all these different films with lots of different people, but he's brilliant. The other film that's coming to my mind is Brassed Off with a whole different
absolutely kind of another Mark Harmon film. Yeah.
That was lovely too. The music in that was really special. And being part of sitting in with the actual Grimthorpe Colliery band, who were the band were telling their story, but they're actually the people in the movie, you know. It was a nice moment where, because I used to play French horn all through school as a French horn player. So I'm playing a tenor horn and I could play it. But so as we're doing this, they made me I think I was meant to be the first tenor horn player. So the actual first tenor horn player was now sitting next to me in the number two seat, which I think he didn't much like. And they gave me this tenor horn. And as we were doing the scene, I was playing along because we had the music. I could play along, but I was slightly flat. And I said to him, I said, why am I flat? It sounds a bit flat when I play. And he went, because you can't play. And I went, oh, okay. So I thought, okay, I'll take it. And then I gave him my horn. I said, just have you have a go. And he had a little play through and he went, it's flat.
Cheeky like, back.
Okay, yes.
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 Listen, we've run out of time, but it's an absolute treat to get to chat to you. And I'm thoroughly enjoying long way up. I just hope you get back there for Christmas once I get to the end of the series.
Well, who knows? Maybe we don't make it, you know. Never, who knows?
Don't spoil it!
It's a cliffhanger. It's a cliffhanger. It's so nice to see you. It's always a pleasure. Lovely to see you.
You too. Take care, and I hope to speak to you again soon, Ewan. Thank you so much.
See you later. Bye-bye.
Bye. Take care.
I mean, I had to ask him about Star Wars, genuinely. I just couldn't bring myself to ask him about the new Star Wars bit, but hopefully I get the chance to catch up with him closer to the time when that's actually going to be released. Anyway, thank you so much for that this week. To Craig, go and see Eternal Beauty. It is out in cinemas now, as I said, and also make sure you listen to this week's episode of the podcast, because he is fabulous and there is loads of the music that's played that you'll hear sprinkled across the podcast. And we also have a Spotify playlist for every episode of the podcast, which features all the music that we play. So with Craig, there'll be a dedicated episode up there on Spotify for all the music and for Ewan as well. So do go and check that out. Sorry, lots of things for you guys to do. I'm sorry to give you so much work, but it's all enjoyable. And to Kat as well, the book is out now and it's really beautiful as well. So yeah, there we go. It's been a lovely episode this week. Thank you so much to everybody for taking the time to chat to me, but also for you guys for listening and watching and checking out. Hopefully you're going to subscribe and tell your friends. And also I just wanted to draw your attention to a special episode that I released earlier this week with Ron Howard and Michelle John, who feature in Rebuilding Paradise, which is an incredible documentary about the fires in California and how they wiped out this time paradise. And as the title says, the rebuilding of that, not just physical town, but the kind of, you know, the spirit of the community as well. Brilliant. Well, that's enough for me for this week. Sorry for wanging on so much. Take care, stay safe, and thank you so much for watching.